Hi everyone, this is Federico. I'm gonna wait for people to show up. We have one viewer. Hi, welcome. Two viewers, good afternoon. So I think while we wait for other viewers to show up, I'm gonna do a quick show and tell and then an announcement. And then we'll get started. Then we'll get started with the kind of doing template, making templates in Cuddle, kind of stuff. Hi, Bernie. Thanks for coming. So anyway, the show and tell while people get started, while people trickle in. So I've been taking this clay exploration class. I'm a beginner with like ceramics, but I like to incorporate digital stuff in my workflow as I go, and so this is something I started doing recently. So in one of the classes, I was kind of introduced to doing to using like paper templates to create your own, you know, I guess this is a common practice where people create paper templates and then like take a slab and cut their thing. So what I did here is that I created this sort of cylinder paper template to make like a cup. And then I kind of drew these with a big Sharpie marker. And then I turned that into, I copied it into Cuddle. And then I kind of drew those same marks. But then I applied these kind of rounding the corners thing. And these were just some like artifacts from having like a little tab, but I thought the artifacts were kind of cool. So I made a clay slab. Then I cut these with the laser cutter. This is just a cheap piece of chipboard. And then I kind of rolled it onto this slab, and then I constructed this cup. So I think it's kind of cool because I ended up with those markings. This hasn't been fired yet. This is just dry, like bone dry. So you can see, you know, here's my seam. It's not super clean, but it's kind of interesting to have all these kind of markings. Here's my cup. And I guess this is another kind of like digital to clay kind of thing. I made a little stamp out of acrylic. It's my name and the date. So anyway, quick show and tell. So quick announcement, I've been putting the videos of this live stream are available on Facebook, but I also started uploading them on the Cuddle YouTube channel. So you can like go to YouTube and search for Cuddle, like so, then you should find the Cuddle YouTube channel, it's just at Cuddle. And on the playlist section, there is one called Facebook Live Sessions.
Generally, the app of the...
I didn't mean to click on that. So on that one, you'll see the recent ones that we have, and then I'll keep on uploading things as we go. Just in case those are easier to find that on the Facebook interface. So cool. So let's get started with today's... Gail says she likes the clay texture. Thank you. That's kind of cool. So let's get started with today. So the thing I have for today is I was thinking I'd give you an introduction to how to use components in Cuddle, or at least a few of the uses of components. So I'll kind of guide you through the thing, and then we'll try and like work on a template. So I'm going to... Here is my kind of dashboard. And then I'm going to create a new blank project to get started. And so I think you're kind of already familiar with components, in that anything you drag from the left-hand side, it's already a component. So, you know, you can use a circle, you know, you can drag a circle onto your canvas. And whenever you drag a component, you know, one of these kind of pre-built ones, you can always change certain settings on that one. So, you know, we can drag a circle and we can have a circle that it's 1 inch, or we can like change the scale and we have another circle that is, you know, whatever scale I gave it. So in a sense, you're sort of already using components by, you know, kind of using the default ones. And you can always search for others here. No, so in the previous sessions, we've been using a lot of connected text. So that's another one. And so that one comes, you know, comes with more things you can change, or different things you can change about it. So of course you can change the text and other things. So another common component, I mean, another kind of interesting one that kind of adds something extra is the polygon component. So that one has the sides. So we can have sort of different sort of instances of that component, and we can change aspects of that particular thing. But those are kind of pre-built aspects. I think another thing, a very kind of obvious use of a component for me, one of the first ones I kind of started playing with, is that I would create a component for when I wanted to put screws or embed magnets on a project. I would create a hole, which would be a simple circle, and then I would kind of reuse that hole all over the project. So I think that's kind of like one of the very basic uses that I started with. So the way I would do that is I would create a circle, you know, I could grab a circle, place it like right on the center, and then, you know, I could give that circle a scale. So I would say like, oh, I need a particular hole that is going to be something like 0.2 inches. And then say I want that to have a stroke color of red. So I kind of know that's the one that I'm using. And I kind of like to name those. So for example, if it's like a screw hole, I could give it a name by, you know, I can double click on the component name, screw hole. And so then I would say, for example, wanna put those in just a simple rectangle. So I'm gonna grab a rectangle. Let's say I'm making something that is like 3 inches. And so then I can use it the same way I'm using sort of the pre-built ones. So I can grab the screw hole and place it where I want it. Say I wanna place it there. And I could just keep on dragging and placing it where I want it. This could be kind of like a very loose way of placing them. And so you can see that I'm kind of grabbing sort of, I guess I could call them clones of the original hole and placing them where I want it. And so one kind of convenient thing about this is that sometimes you are doing a project and you're like, oh no, I need to like change the size of all these, like, you know, other five holes I placed on my project. So you can always go back. I mean, if you were to drag individual holes and then size them, then you would have to sort of go back and change the size of all of those kind of manually. But what the components offer you is like an easy way of changing, say, the size of all of them. So one way to do it is I could go back here and change the size of all of them. I could call it 0.3. And then all of them should have changed size. So that's one way. Another way in which I can do it is I can double click the individual component. If I double click into it, I'll go into this thing called like focus mode. So I get this kind of spotlight around it. And so if I make changes here, I'm doing it here because it's going to be obvious. If I make changes here, then it's going to kind of change all the instances of that component. So that's why it would be convenient to do it, especially for hole sizes or kind of embeds. So I think that covers kind of like my first kind of very basic use of components. But there is more. There is cool things that you can do. So for example, I think you can kind of create your own sort of remixes, I could call them, of existing things. So I think an easy one would be something like this. So let's say you want to use a star. So that's like your basic star component. I'm going to name it right away. But in your design, you want to have stars that are kind of like, you know, that have kind of rounded edges. So I'm going to select that one and I'm going to apply the round corners. So I get kind of these like knobby kind of thing. And so that's kind of cool. But maybe you want to have like multiple instances of your star that has like different number of corners. So one thing I can do is I can go to the star and I can extract these points, the number of points. So I can click on the three dots next to points, and then there is one that says extract as parameter. And so that kind of places it here separately. So the convenient thing about that is that now, whenever I kind of drag this component over here, I can have like sort of different versions of the clone. It's not a clone anymore, I guess. So I can drag that one. I'm going to drag another one, and you see that I have this number of points. And so I can create sort of variations upon the component I just made by creating this kind of additional thing. So I think this is useful in a design sense, in that you can make all these decisions, but then like create variations upon the thing you made. So, and of course, if you go back to edit the original one, and we can do certain edits, like for example, let's say we wanted it to be red, and that is going to apply to all the instances that we made, except for that one detail that we extracted, like the number of points. So I think that kind of gives you an introduction to, hopefully that gives you a sense of like all the things that components can do. But yesterday I was hanging out with Toby and we came up with this kind of wacky idea. I mean, I'm going to call it wacky, but I think it's kind of interesting. An interesting example of doing something that uses like components in this way, but in a more elaborate manner. We started thinking about this sort of rainbow cake topper. That's what I'm going to call it. So let's build this kind of rainbow cake topper. So I'm just going to create a new project so I can start fresh. So the idea is that I want sort of some text that is around an arc. So, and we'll see how this evolves. So one convenient way of doing it is to search for text. And there is this text around a circle version thing that I can have here. And so what this one allows me to do is that it creates I have a circle, and then that circle can actually be sized. If I select the circle, it has a scale parameter here. So that's kind of like the diameter of the circle. And then I have the text that I can put around the circle. So I could put something like, I could put a name. So that's the start. I want to put text kind of like in that sort of rainbow situation. And so to make life convenient, I'm going to go ahead and extract the text as parameter or the name. So click on the three dots. By the way, you can ask me any questions as I go. I'm kind of looking at the chat. So I'm going to extract that parameter that creates that one called text. I'm going to just call it, just give it text. Text is fine. So whenever I change that, I can get that name. And then another thing I want to do really quick is I found this cool font that I like. It's called Love. Yeah, that's kind of cool. This one is like an all uppercase font, which is kind of interesting. I don't have to, if I type lowercase here, it will show up as uppercase. So that's the start. So I know that the circle is right now, it's a 4-inch scale. And so what I want is a sort of arc. And I'm going to construct the arc myself. I'm going to grab a circle. Hopefully this is another funny trick. So the circle has a scale here, so it's 1 inch. But I want just like half of the circle, but I'm just gonna do this kind of funny thing where, like, instead of a component that has this, I'm gonna deconstruct it. I'm gonna go to edit, and then I'm gonna convert it to paths. And so what that does is that now if I double click into it, I can actually go ahead and edit the path itself. So I can kind of select the individual sections or even the anchors. So if I select the anchor and hit the delete key, that kind of gets rid of that anchor, but I can also select the path, the line in between, and delete that. And so that gives me an arc. And so I want this arc to match the circle where the text lives. So in order to match those dimensions, I'm gonna, transform it, and I'm gonna extract this scale as a parameter. So now if I change that, that changes that. And then I'm gonna make the circle where the text lives use that scale. Let's call it maybe the arc. That's the dimension that it uses. So I'm gonna just type it here. So arc scale, yeah. So that should match. Now I get this arc that matches the place where the circle lives. And then I can control that scale here. That looks good. Maybe I want the text to live kind of like on top of it. So I'm gonna go back and change that. And if I look at the text along path, there should be an alignment. So vertical align, I want it to be on the baseline. So you can see that that kind of moves it to the baseline of the circle. Here are other examples to make it more clear. Top, bottom, baseline seems to work for me. And then I'm gonna give this arc like some dimension. So let's call it, let's use the one called outline stroke. That gives it like some thickness. Let's say something like 0.2 to start with. And you know, the text, I kind of want it to be connected to the arc, but a little bit higher. So I'm going to go ahead and change another thing here that I can change on that, which is the vertical offset. Yeah, so that kind of moves it up a tiny bit. You see where I'm going with this rainbow thing, right? So so now I think, let's make it neat. I want the path to have the caps be round. That kind of rounds the edges here. It'd be unnecessary, but it looks cool. And then I'm gonna select everything and I'm gonna apply these Boolean union or weld. So I'm gonna call this one the arched name. So I did all these things, but now call back to the previous thing we were doing before. Now it kind of works on its own, meaning I can actually kind of drag it, place it where I want it, and each one of these instances is going to have its own set of parameters that I can change a little bit compared to like the number of points on a star. I can drag another one here and then say I want like a smaller scale for that one. And then I want a different name or a different text. And then I can drag another one and then scale it down. So this is cool. I think this got to an interesting place, I think. Because now we can have like a sort of triple text kind of cake topper. I was thinking that this would be cool if you kind of, you know, stick it on a cake and you have kind of like nice text right there. But maybe it needs a little bit more tweaking to like get it to the place where it's going to work out. So let's say I want this one to be, let's say if you want to write something like happy birthday Olivia or something. So, oh, something like happy 18th. Then on the next one, I want to write birthday. And the next one, Olivia, or the name. And then I want to just kind of tweak it so the overlap is, so it overlaps roughly. So I don't know, with this one, like 4.2, then we can do the next one, like 3.2, makes sense? No, like something like that. I'm just going to eye it. And then I can go ahead and apply, if I apply the Boolean union, I think it's readable, but it, some things kind of disappear. So I'm going to do the fancy one, which is the weld and score, because then it gives me those extra blue lines that make it more readable. So you can see where I where I got there, right? There's a question. When you extract a parameter, the question is about extracting parameters. And whether, yeah, and whether they become local or global. So if I understood it well, yeah, so when I extracted it here, that becomes a local parameter. So that only applies to that instance. In order to make a global one, it's better if you create it yourself. And so that kind of segues a little bit into probably what I would want to do next with this template. I'm going to call it rainbow. Rainbow cake topper. I think what would make these a little better is that, for example, right now, if I want to change any of the existing names or the text right here, I would have to like go into each one of them. I kind of have to understand the structure here on the left. So if I kind of hover over each one of those, I know which one it is. I know the first one, the one called number one, number two, and number three. Number one is the top section. So I would have to go in here and change that. And then I would have to go in here and change that. Let's say if it's anniversary. And then here is the name. So, sorry, number three is the name. So that gets complicated, but we can make it a little better. So this is where like I'm gonna create this global parameter. And there's a question about go over local and global parameters again. So let's explain it a little bit. So when I do a local parameter, so I'm, as an example, I have this circle, and then I can extract, say, the scale as a parameter. That scale right here applies only to this specific circle. Or so, for example, when I, yeah, so it's going to apply just to this one circle that I created. But if I want this parameter to apply to multiple things, let's say, I have like another parameter that is a rectangle, and I want the same, you know, I would like this circle, when I change its scale, to match the scale of the rectangle, then I can use something called a global parameter. So something that can sort of put its tentacles, its fingers into all the components that I create. So I'm going to delete these. Well, I guess I could. Let me make sure the circle is here. So as an example, I'm going to create a global one right here. And I'm going to I only have 5 minutes to finish this, but I'll finish it. So I'm going to say I have this scale, and I'm going to say that is 1 inch. So I want these, I'm going to call it example scale. So what I'm doing with this global one is I want that one, this parameter to control both the circle. So in that case, I'm going to sort of plug in that global parameter into the circle, example scale. And I also want to plug in that global parameter. You can see that it's global also because whenever I change components, it kind of stays here on the UI. And so I want to plug in that scale onto the square as well. So now if I have both the circle and the square, if I change that the scale that I created, let's give it some resolution, that applies to both. So that is convenient because, yeah, sometimes you have things like these where you want the scale to apply to both things and the global parameter is driving it. But now to sort of connect it to what we were doing before, I'm actually going to get rid of that one. I'm going to delete that one. Oh, I deleted everything. I suppose I don't have to. Obsessive into keeping it clean. So now I'm going to create 3 global parameters to finish this cake topper thing, because I just want an easy way to like input the text into those layers. It's not the most elegant template, but hopefully you can see how it goes. So I want to create one for the top text. I'm going to create one for the middle text. And I want to create one for the bottom text. Importantly, I want to make these into a parameter type that is text. So I can go to the 3 dots and select text. So I'm going to do the same thing for each one of them. Text, click the 3 dots, parameter type, text. And now I want to sort of, the same way I plugged in that example scale into others, I'm going to plug it in to these existing ones. So I know that the top text is this one. And also importantly, I need to hit the 3 dots and enter edit expression. Why is that important? Is because if I were to do what I want to do, which is just simply to type top text here, then I would just get top text. But if I edit the expression, I can, you see now it appears kind of reddish with quotation marks. I can actually type top text without quotation marks and it autofills for me. So now that got plugged in into there. So now let's do the middle one, and I want to do the same. Edit expression, that would be my middle text. And the bottom one, edit expression. Hopefully the repetition helps the learning. I mean, delete that. And if I start typing bottom, you can see that it autofills and I can just grab the one that I created. I'm gonna do it with time. 1 more minute, okay. So now I have an easy way to hit the text here. So I can do a happy friends. Oh no, happy Father's Day, because that's kind of coming. And now I can like turn it fully into a template. I can go to, I mean, it's already a template, but I can go to the README, which is a section where we can write notes and just create this kind of clean component situation. And there, so we have the sort of happy Father's Day cake topper, or happy 18th anniversary. Happy 18th anniversary day, sure, of friendship. Anyway, you get the idea. Anyway, hopefully this was an interesting kind of dive, kind of deep dive into the components, and how to kind of create a sort of layered template. I hope you liked it. Thanks for coming and asking questions, and then I'll see you in the next one. The video is going to be available both on Facebook immediately, and then I'll post it to YouTube later on. Cool. I'm going to end the video, keep it short. Bye, everyone.